So in today's lab, we will be implementing the basic web service, and we'll test the web service. So for that, all of you have installed the Visual Studio. I hope that all of you have the Visual Studio installed on your system. So open Visual Studio instance and then create a new project. As part of the new project, you need to select the language as C#, and the type of project you need to select WCF Service Library. Yes, if WCF is not installed, you need to go to the new feature, install new feature while creating a new project, and then you need to select for the WCF library or the WCF feature. You have to install it via the through the internet. Hello sir, is I think sir is sharing the screen, and there is a on the bottom of the screen you can see that install more tools and features.
Yes, I'll give you the exact demo. Then I'm just sharing my screen once again. So you need to go to the individual components, right? That is the first thing, right? Okay, and then you need to go to I'm just scrolling so that you can follow my screen. Yes, can you see this Windows Communication Foundation? So that should be selected, right? And then you can click on add or modify. I think you might be getting a modify option, right? Is that available? Modify option? Yes, yes. Okay, so it will take just 5 or 10 minutes. You might be asked to restart the Visual Studio, right? And then you can install, right? Yes. And when you will have installed it, you will be able to see this kind of project. Let me just go to that. So you will see this screen after it is modified. Right? So modify, launch, and more. You can just click on launch. That will open up the studio once again. And then you can just type in WCF. So you will get number of options, and out of that you need to select WCF service library that gives you a DLL, right? And we'll be following C sharp, so this option, right? Don't select the VB part. Yes, sir, is that fine? Okay, so once it is installed, you can start working as per source instruction. Yes, sir, now you can explain the details. Okay, so I hope all of you have installed it, right? Yes, okay. So I'll just give you a demo how to create a WCF service library project, and I'll explain how that actually works, right? So let me just go to my Visual Studio. Yes, yes, Shail, no problem. I'm waiting. I'm on the project page, right? No problem. Anyone else who is still not ready, you can let me know. Yes, yes, no problem, no problem. So all of you give me your status, right? So once you are ready, then we'll take a demo, okay? And others, meanwhile, you can create the WCF service library project, right? And just go through it once, right? Those who have already installed, okay? It will take time for some systems, right? If the internet is slow, it may take time. Yes, it is WCF service library, and make sure that you are going through C#, right? Not VB, because it shows you two options, right? Yes, okay. Yes, I'm waiting. I'm just on the project home page, right? So all of you, once all of you reach this page, we will begin, right? And meanwhile, as I said, those who have completed installation, they can start creating the project and just go through the code, right? Yes, we are not supposed to modify that. We'll go with the default, right? Yes. WCF service and WCF service library. Yes, so WCF service is actually a website, right? While WCF service library, I'll explain that actually. It is a collection of three things. It provides you a way to create your service, right? Plus, it is also going to give you the hosting logic, right? And it can also, you can say, prompt you with a test client, fine? The service library is actually a 3-in-1 application where you can design a service, plus the same application can act as a host, right? As well as it can create a demo client, or you can say test client. Is that fine, Kenneth? Ideally, we would be creating all three as separate projects, right? But as this is the first time, we are going with a combined option, right? So service library is a collection, basically, right? Okay, Keval has completed. What about Shail and Rikin? Are you done? Okay, Rikin has completed. Okay, Shail, you need more time, right? Okay. So what we can do is, you can have a look at the demo right now, and then once your installation is complete, you can do it, right, Shail? Will that be fine? And you can let me know if you are facing any difficulties in between, okay? So you let the installation run in background, okay? And focus on the meet, right? Okay. Yes, so let us begin. Anyone else who is still left? I hope all of you are done, right? Okay. So let us start. So as I said, you have to create a WCF service library project, right? Then click on next. Okay. So you can give any name over here. I'm going with default WCF service library 1. Location is by default .NET framework. I'm not changing, right? And if I click on create, okay, so let me share my screen once again. I think I lost the screen share. Okay, can you all see my screen? After the project is created? Okay. So, see, service is actually or when you talk about WCA service, it supports two major files, or you can say two major types of files. One will be this service1.cs. This is automatically created. The code is again auto-generated. This is just to let us know how we can work with a basic WCF application. Fine. So service1.cs is actually your class file. Right? As you can see over here, I'll just zoom in further. Yes. You can see this is class service1. And there are two methods, right? Get data and get data using data contract. So this data contract term you will be studying, sir will be covering this in theory portion in the lectures basically. So we are not touching upon this method right now. Just focus on this method which is shown on the screen. So what parameter is it is accepting? What type of parameter? Can you read that? It is integer, yes. And it is returning what? It is returning a string. Okay, so it is a simple operation. Whatever client will enter as a number, suppose you enter 10 as a number, right? So the service will respond with you entered and then number. Clear with that much? Right? It's a simple C# function, right? Okay. But this class implements a certain interface, right? And that's what we have over here, right? iService1. Okay, so this is an interface. You all know how to write an interface in C#. But there is a difference over here. What you see over here is called annotations or attributes, right? Service contract, operation contract, and again operation contract, right? So if you want to classify this interface as a WCF service, right, the interface is always decorated with a service contract attribute. Service contract attribute. Is that fine? The interface of your WCF application will be decorated with service contract attribute. Okay. And whatever operations you declared in the class, right, if you want to share them with your client, right, I'm again repeating, if you want to expose them to the client side, decorate them with operation contract attribute. Here, decorate every operation with operation contact attribute. Is that fine? Right? Okay, so does that mean if I remove this operation contract from here, what will be the effect of that? If I remove operation contract from here? Yes. Client cannot access that method. Correct. Yes. It won't be accessible on the client side general, right? Yes. So that is what is the meaning. I'm just doing rollback. Fine. So we'll focus on this operation only right now. Fine. Operation contract, string, get data, and integer value. Okay. So this is the service part. Fine. Now, how this service is hosted? Right, that logic or that part is written in case of app.config file. If you observe your config file, before that, let me just show you the namespace that we use. Can you see this system.service model? Right, so this is the main namespace from which all the methods of WCF services are deriving. Right, so this namespace is compulsory if you want to implement your WCF web service, right? Another, if you observe over here, we are having a namespace called system.runtime.serialization. Can you tell me why do we need serialization? Serialization means converting from one format to the other. Right? So where do we require serialization? Yes, XML to object. So over here, the integer parameter, right? The client will be sending the data in integer format, right? So that integer has to be converted to XML format. Getting that value has to be converted in form of XML, right? Similarly, the response string that you are sending has to be converted to XML. Yes. So that is called serialization, right? We have to do conversion, and that happens at runtime. So this is a namespace for that, system.runtime.serialization. Fine. So now if you observe the hosting part, right? The hosting logic that is written over here. So the first thing that you will observe is system.service model. Right? Again, this is an XML file. You know how to read an XML file now. So system.service model covers the entire definition, right? So what is the first level element? Can you read this one? It is services, right? So system.service model provides how many services your host is currently handling, okay? Inside that we have service element, okay? Then you have the name of the service. And can you interpret what is this naming convention? What is WCF service library 1? It is same as project name. Dot, what is service 1? It is class name, correct. It is class name, right? So that is the naming convention. That is, your service is identified as this name, right? But ultimately, what you will be exposing to the client? Will you be exposing your class file or interface file? In form of WSDL, you can say. You will be sharing the interface, correct, right? So that is defined as a part of the endpoint, right? So let me just explore this part. So as you can see, over here, they have defined an endpoint, right? Endpoint is a way to communicate with the service, right? And every endpoint contains three things, A, B, and C, where A stands for the address, right? B stands for binding, and C stands for contract, okay? So if you want to communicate with any WCF service, you must have access to some endpoint. Are you getting the basic idea? You must have access to some endpoint. Okay. Now, what do you mean by address? It will be the URL. Okay. It will be the URL. Now, as you can see in this code, you have an auto-generated base address. You can see this element, right? Base address. And there is an address called HTTP localhost 8733 design time address, right? So this is the default address that your service will be accessible through, okay? And then when we create the endpoint, this part is left blank. Can you tell me why? Yes, if you will read the comment, you will understand. It is, if it is not fully qualified, that means if you not return this value as fully qualified name, it will be following the base address, correct? All of you understand this, right? So basically, if you want to connect to the service, you can use this base address, which is defined over here, right? Now, binding defines the protocol that your service uses for communication, fine? Now, as you can see, the binding type is basic HTTP binding. So which is the protocol we are using over here? It is HTTP protocol, right? As well as you can see, the address is in HTTP format, right? The other options are, you can use TCP as a protocol, right? If you want to create a LAN-based application or something like that, right? And the another option that you have is a named pipe. I hope you remember, we have seen this in OS. Yes, pipe concept. So pipe is used for inter-process communication. Right? So within the same machine, if you want to have communication between processes, you can use pipe binding. Okay, so we'll be covering all those details, right, in the lecture, right? So let us continue. So binding is declared next, so that is the B part. And then the next part comes, which is more important, is a contract. Can you identify what is this? Okay, let me just go back to that. Yes. WCF service library 1 dot iService 1, that is your interface name, correct, right? So ultimately, we'll be exposing our interface outside, okay? But if you want to connect to a service, you need to connect to the endpoint. Endpoint is the sole mechanism to connect to the service. Are you clear with this? Yes? Okay, the details will be covered by sir in class, right? You will be studying this in detail. Today we are just taking a demo, so I'm just giving you an overview, right? This is accessible by all other people in the world? No, unless they know this address, Janil. If they know the address, right, then it is accessible. Yes, this is the hosting platform, right? So if you make this code accessible, or if you make this URL public, right, they can use your service. Got it? So over here, we are actually configuring. Yes, yes, security can be added. It can be added. You will be studying all those things, right, in detail. Yes, yes, okay. Now, this is one endpoint, right? Remember, this is just one endpoint. Now, we have one more endpoint. Let us look at that. If I just close all these things, right? You can see there is one more endpoint whose address is max, right? Now, can you tell me why it is only max, not the absolute address? So, how the actual address will be generated if I want to connect to this endpoint? Yes, base address slash max, correct, right? It is related, okay? This endpoint is used for metadata exchange, right? And that is why binding is max HTTP binding. This is another type of binding which is used for metadata exchange. And by metadata, what do I mean is your WSDL file, okay? So if a client wants to talk with the service, first of all, you should know what are the operations it is exposing, right? And to know the operation, we should have the WSDL file, right? We have seen that in theory, right? Okay. So for that, there is a special type of binding you can say .NET framework provides, which is prefixed with max, right? The protocol is again HTTP, right? But it is prefixed with max, right? Similarly, you have max TCP binding, max pipe binding, right? Depending upon the protocol type, the binding name will change. Okay. And look at the contract. Right. We have one more interface name, iMetadata Exchange. This interface is responsible for sharing the WSDL details with the client. Okay. And where will be the definition of this interface? Have we written that in our code? Yes, can you guess where will be the definition of this? Central database, okay. Any other guesses? Does the service library provide WSDL file? I'll explain that process, right? Where we store WSDL, yes, I'll come to that point. So iMetadata Exchange is actually defined by system.service model namespace, is that fine? Is that question answered first? It is declared within system.service model namespace, right? Now, when some client connects with your service for the first time, right? For that, the URL should be known. In case of WCF, the URL or base address should be known. But can you tell me, will they connect to this endpoint or max endpoint? I'm just expanding this. Will they be connecting to this endpoint or max endpoint? What do you think? First time, right? You're not calling a method. You just want the WSDL file. Yes. Can anyone tell me? You will connect to the max endpoint. That's correct. You will connect to the max endpoint. So once you are connected to the max endpoint, right, this contract, iMetadata Exchange, will make sure that the WSDL details are shared with the client. Correct, Janil, right? Understood this much? First, you are connecting to the max endpoint, okay? And under one assumption that you know the base address, okay? And then you will be connecting to the second endpoint once WSDL is available, right? Because once you know the WSDL, you know what are the operations in the service, right? And then you can easily call this service, okay? So how many messages will be exchanged? Message number one will be for what? For getting wisdom, right? From Max, that's correct. Message number two will be the reply, right? And that reply will contain what? Your wisdom file. Is that clear? Understood? Yes. Message number three will be what? To send the data, or you can say the call the operation, right? Okay. And message number four will be the response. Are you getting? Yes. So this will happen in background. Okay. This is the process that happens in background. So this hosting code will make sure that the clients can connect to appropriate endpoint. Max is for all interfaces under this project. So basically Max is, you can say, a unique endpoint which will share the metadata or WSDL with all clients, I would say. Are you getting this? Any client who wants to communicate with this service, right, they will be getting the WSDL by connecting to the Max endpoint. Okay. Once Max or metadata detail, why it is called Max? Because it is metadata exchange. Metadata exchange, right? And then you will be connecting to this actual endpoint, right, for passing the messages. Okay. Now I'll run this project so that we can see the demo, right? So you just have to build this first, right? Okay, so build is succeeded. WSDL does not contain the required functionality. So if you have written operation contract, shell, on each operation, then those operations will be shared. But if you have not written operation contract, then that functionality will not be shared. Are you getting? Yes, yes. So let us run this, right, so that you can see the window. Okay, let me just switch to the client window. Let me just share my complete screen. Okay, now we all are on the same page. Right, can you see this test client window, WCF test client, right? Yes, okay. So this provides the multiple types of information, right? If you observe the first part, what is this? Yes, which address is that? Localhost 8733 WCF service library / max, right? Base address / max. That means you connected to the max endpoint. Right, you connected to the max endpoint, and from there you got this information. Are you getting the meaning? Right, this is a dummy client, or you can say demo client window, that connected you to the max endpoint automatically. Right, we will learn in class also how to do this manually, so we'll cover that in detail. Right, but today we'll just look at the demo. Right, okay. Then what that shares with you. What that max endpoint shares with you? The WSDL. And in WSDL, what we are interested in? Yes, in the WSDL file, what we are interested in the interface, yes or no? Correct, right? Interface contains the methods. Can you see this two methods? Get data and get data sync, right? Okay. Now, if I double click on any method, right? You can see on the right hand side an input window comes up, right? Now if I enter 10 over here, can you see my input that I'm providing? Okay, then you need to click the invoke, right? And it will ask you that you are sending information over the network, right? So we agree, right? If I click on okay, you will be able to see the response. Can you see this response in the bottom? You entered 10. Okay. So when I made this call, which endpoint was invoked? or which endpoint was connected to. It was not MEX, it was the basic endpoint. Yes, right? Correct. Right. Now, if you want to look at the SOAP message, that looks like this, right? You just have to switch the tab. You can see formatted tab and XML tab. Okay. See how my data is serialized, right? You can see this value and then 10. Okay. 10 is the value embedded within the value element. It is nothing but an XML file. Okay. So message contains two things. We'll be covering this in theory also tomorrow. Right? There's a header and there is a body portion. Right? Inside the body, you are going to have your data. Is this understood? Request message. Right. Then you have the response message, right? In response message, see, you can see this, you enter 10. You enter 10 is being shown, right? And again, this is inside the body portion, right? Inside the body element, okay? Header is empty because we are not customizing this message. It is the default generated message, okay? One more thing I would like to show you is a config file, right? This is the client config, right? So when you connect to the MAX endpoint, you'll be getting the visual details. And based on the visual details, on client side, one more configuration file gets generated. And that is this, right? So can you see this endpoint detail over here, right? But why there is only one endpoint? Any guess on that? Why there is only one endpoint, which you can see? Okay. Let me just read the comments. MAX shouldn't be shared. One endpoint for one method for the request of the client. So basically, you assume that we have already connected to the MAX endpoint, isn't it? Right? We have already connected to the MAX endpoint. So now, do we need to keep that MAX information with us? Do we need to keep that address available? No, right? Only what is important now? Communication endpoint address. That is the other address or base endpoint. Are you getting? Right? So on the client side, which information is saved? The details of communication endpoint. We don't actually call it base, but it is called as communication endpoint. If you want to say in general, there are two types of endpoints. One is communication, the other is MAX endpoint. Understood, right? So can I design more than communication endpoints for a service? Like this using HTTP. Can we have one more endpoint with TCP protocol? Can we have one more endpoint with pipe protocol? Yes, right? So it is possible. Okay, we'll be learning that through the process. When sir will take the next classes, he will explain you how to create number of endpoints in different ways. So are you clear with this demo now, right? So you need to try this on your own, right? Okay. More details will be covered in class, as I said. Okay, we have just touched upon the basics. Okay, fine. So I'm just stopping the screen share. You just apply this, right, on your systems. And let us know if you are facing any difficulty, right? Try this test client project out, right, and see the details. So actually, we have covered three aspects. Right? We have seen service, we have seen hosting logic in the config file, and we have also seen the client window. Right? That is a feature of WCF service library project. So once you are done with this basic test client, right, the next step is you need to modify the same code so that you can implement four operations, addition, subtraction, multiply, and division, right, in the same service. Can you tell me what are the changes required? In which files have to be changed? Yes, you have to add four methods in class, right? Correct. And same four methods have to be added in the interface, right? And don't forget to decorate. Don't forget to add operation contact on each method. Correct? Understood? And then using the test client, you test the operations. Okay, and also check the XML part, how the message is being sent, request message, and how you are receiving the response. Are you clear with the name, right? No need to create a new project. In the same project, you just modify. Yes, this is WCF service library project. So in this case, config is automatically generated, but we will learn how to write it, right? So I will be covering that. There are two approaches. You can write config in XML form, or you can do it in code that is using C# code. Right? Both the approaches are possible. Okay, so you will be learning that in this and the next week in detail. Right? Yes. So you let me know once this calculator task is done, right, so that we can go ahead. You can just type in done when you complete this. Yes, so that 8733 is a reserved port shell basically. So that is why it is allowing you to use that, right? Some ports are you can say it is available, right? 8733. So if you will change that, you will definitely get an error, right? Or you might require admin privileges, right, to use any other port. So that also will be covered in upcoming lectures, how to use different ports, right? Okay, it shows error while using 8733. So what did you change? Can you write the complete change over here? And what is the error message you are getting? Can you just give me the detail? Yes, yes, no problem. Because 8733 is actually an open port, which is accessible by Studio. So the error should not be due to that port number. Okay. Okay, it seems that the port is being used by some of the applications. So what you can do is you can close your Studio once, just restart the Studio and see if it is working out, right? Or we can try changing it, right? Changing the port number. It seems that that is being used by some other application. Yes. And what about others? Are you able to do it? Those who did not write done. Any other difficulties you are facing? Okay. Just type your status once you complete, right? So that we can go ahead. Okay, many of you completed. Good. And I hope all of you are able to test all operations, right, of the calculator service.
Yes, Kenil, what is your doubt? Hello, sir. You can try to change the port number from 8733. You can change it to 9000. Any such port number. You change it to say 8000 and try it again. Kenil, what is your doubt? I am not getting your question because see that when we run our application, the WCF test client will read through the app.config file, and from that it will find out the address on which web service is running. Actually, in between there is a SVC host application. So normally what we require when we develop a web application, we need to deploy it onto the server. So here there is an application called SVC host. Let me type in the name SVC. So see that when we run our project, what will happen? The studio will host our service onto this host application. It will host it and then it will open the test client, WCF test client. So from that it will fetch this data, the URL, and using that URL it will try to communicate with the endpoint. So there are two endpoints, one is MAX and another is the communication endpoint. So it will try to contact to the communication endpoint, and because the service is hosted and it is running, and that's why through the WCF test clients we are able to invoke the get data method. So the flow is same, but because we are running right now and some of the things are done transparent to us, so we don't know what is happening. But actually what we require, we need to develop the service, we need to host it, and on the host it will run. For any web application, what we do normally, we create a web application, we create a WAR file or jar file, and we deploy it onto say Tomcat, Apache or IIS server, and then the client can access it. So here also the same set of steps are needed. We need to create the web service, we need to host it on the server. There are different ways of hosting the web service. Say for WCF service, you can host it on IIS server, or you can self host it also. And then on the IIS server, on the self hosting, it will be running, and then the client can communicate to the service to fetch the visual file. And from that it will get the information, and then it will be able to communicate to the address specified in the WSDL file, and then it can invoke the operations like get data, add, subtract and other operations. So this is the way it is working right now. Later on we'll see that we will create our own host in which we will deploy our web service, and then we'll also write our own client. Right now we are dependent on the WCF test client, which is inbuilt. Similarly, we are dependent on this service host, which is automatically host the web service and run it. So these things are needed. I think you have used any Tomcat Apache server wherein you can deploy your web application, and then you can start the service instance, or rather web application instance. Yes or no? You might have used PHP MyAdmin kind of, or XAMPP server, WAMP server are there, LAMP server are there, right? From which that admin point you can start the web application instance, right? On the server side, you can stop it. So what you require, server on which, or host on which you need to deploy the application. Next step is to run it, and then only the client would be able to access your web application. So here the steps are for hosting your web service, starting the host. Host should run the web service, and then we should be able to, using the client, we should be able to communicate to the web service. good that you are asking few questions so that the doubts gets clear. And once you are finished with this, you can the next task is to write a schema file for your XML. So identify any two entities for your project, and if you already written XML file, then it is fine. Otherwise, create the XML file for those two entities and write down the schema file for your XML file. So write down the rules for the structure of your XML, but write down the rules for the data as part of it. For example, mobile number validation, email address validation, those you write it as the schema validation rules. So create two XML file and corresponding to XSD file, and then validate your XML file against the schema file. Right, because see that normally in Windows operating system or other operating system, some firewalls are installed. They will not allow the third party applications to run it. So basically the firewall will stop you running that application. So only admin can do so. So there are two steps. You have to enable that port. Basically you need to allow that port to run. So there are two ways: you run as an administrator, or you simply enable that port in your firewall settings. So I will show you a command in Windows. There is a netsh command through which you can enable any port. By default, all the unreserved ports are disabled. Due to security reasons, the operating system has the firewall built in, and that it will stop any application to use unreserved ports. Okay, I will show you that how to enable the port in Windows. Just a minute. Are you able to see this command? So you can open the console. You open that command prompt as an admin, and then you need to run this command on the Windows Power Shell. You can run this command netsh. Basically, we want to allow this HTTP protocol to use this protocol on any application running that particular port number. Say the port number is 8010, but you can specify or enable any such port number, and for specific Windows user. So this is a command, admin command, for enabling a firewall rule to enable the application which uses the HTTP protocol over the port number 8010. Similarly, you can add as many port numbers as you wish. So right now you can, if your firewall is denying to run the application, you can enable that port number via this rule. Firewall rule, You can add say 8000, 8001, 8002, 8003 and so forth. So at least enable 4-5 ports numbers, because in the later applications we'll need multiple web service or multiple applications running on different port numbers. So in that case, we will require at least 2-3 port numbers to be enabled. Please note down this command, everybody. For this lab, you identify any two entities of your project, like suppose customer, product, order. Identify any two such entities and write down the XML files. If you already written the XML file, you need to write down the schema file for them, accessed files. Right? And you need to validate and check that your XML document data is validated against the schema file that you have written. And then you can write down the rules, like some of the fields are required or attributes are required, or the email address is valid. You can use the pattern attribute as part of the schema to check that it is a valid email. You can check for the mobile number that is consisting of only numbers or digits only. Likewise, those rules can be written in the schema file. Yeah, so in the previous lab you have written DTD, now in this lab you need to write down the XSD. I hope that everybody has finished that calculator part. Anyone facing a difficulty or any other issues, please share your issue over here. Because you need to add a few more options, add, subtract, multiply, and divide. And then if you simply add those operations as part of the operation contract in your interface, and then you can implement them, and then you can invoke them via the WCF test client. Okay, no problem. We have times. You can finish that part as well as you can start with designing schema file.
Okay, so the assignment has been posted. So your XML files and XSD files both will have to be submitted. Right? You need to create a zip file, okay? And that's what you can submit on the Google Classroom. If there are no queries, you can leave the meeting now. We will meet in the next lab. Yes, yes, Janet. You need to create a zip file, XML when with XSD, right? Both of them you have to submit. Yes, if you submitted XML in lab 2, then also you need to submit today itself for this lab also, right? So XML plus XSD. If there are two XML files, there should be two XSD files, okay? One-to-one mapping is required. Yes. Okay, okay, fine. We'll meet in the next lab then. Thank you.